Now, from this joint pedal here...
Yes?
I'd like to go to this small blue box here.
Ah.
And you tell me what this one does.
Yeah. Well, this is the Roland guitar synthesizer. Here's the guitar. Here's
You have to have that guitar to go with it, there.
Yes, because all the controls are built into the guitar that operate this part of the setup. This is the second one they've made. The first one was very nice, but not very easy to use on stage. It was too complicated. This one is great because it's on the floor, and you can switch everything off and on with your foot. And it sounds like this. See, I like to use this pedal with it because it opens the filter.
Yeah, it gives
on
it
the foot.
Great
yeah,
reward.
That's right.
Is that the effect that you used on Don't Stand So Close?
That's exactly it.
Did you use any of this with this as well?
Yes, I also use the pedal board in conjunction with this. I usually use the flanger and the echoplex with the synthesizer. And the guitar solo in the middle is played on this guitar. But to achieve the effect that is on the record, I use the duet switch here, which means that you can add an extra interval to any note you're playing. And I like to tune the guitar synthesizer in fifths. And then play strange chords as well. And then
so
you start
what effect
to get a
does that give?
Well, you get a very strange sound. This is now, I've just switched it into fifths. So, sounds like this.
What would that sound like without the fifths?
Fifths is straight, it's a straight sound like this. You can see now this down here, this one switch will switch in any interval you want. So this is tuned in fifths now, so you get this. See? Unison.
Weeks in which to write most of the material for this album. Did you find it sort of only came in the last week or something like that?
No, as I say, I write in bits and bobs, you know, a bit here, a bit there. It is like a jigsaw.
Yeah.
In the last week,
we'll go with that one.
Yeah.
Well, you were mentioning a song a minute ago that's going to be on this new album.
One song I really like on the album is called The Invisible Sun, which I wrote on this thing here. This is my pedals.
Really? It was actually written on this?
Well, yeah, in a way. This is like a foot piano, which I play on stage. Has a bass sound. I've also got a synthesizer sound.
Yeah.
So I was just sitting at home one night with playing E flat on there, and I played this. Great.
So it was straight down, yeah?
Straight
Did Dennis
down.
Get involved?
Dennis was involved at a later date, like yeah. So. That's all right. See why we have Andy Summers in the group.
Yeah. He's a man for the colds.
No, he's a man for playing the guitar.
Oh, I say, yeah.
I bring these duff.
Did you, I mean,
renditions along to him.
When you do give the song to the band, do you always go into a rehearsal room first, or do you come straight into the recording studio?
We haven't got time to go to rehearsal room. We go straight in the studio, and if it's not happening within half an hour, we ditch it.
Go on to something else.
Yeah, we're very impatient, but I think that's a good way. The pressure's always on, you know. It has to be good very soon, very quickly.
Yeah.
If it's not, out the window.
Do you have it live, or do you have a lot of overdubs and edits?
It usually has to work with the three musicians playing it and me singing.
Yeah.
And that's usually good enough.
Yeah.
A couple times Sting brought in, every little thing she does is magic. He brought in a demo. We could have just put it on the radio right there. Hit. Right there, with his little squeaky drum box, with his, you know, guitar playing instead of, whatever. It was a hit right there. And our problem was, how could we make it our hit, you know? And so, you know, we went back and forth and back and forth. But most of the songs, we would hear them, and within an hour or two, we'd lay down the backing track, and that's the record. For the drums, anyway. The bass, the guitar, they would spend the next few weeks redoing the guitar, layering more versions of guitar, changing everything. But the drums were recorded an hour or two from hearing the song for the first time.
Well, I have a running battle with Sting and his drumming machine.
What do you think of drum machines generally?
They're great. I use them all the time myself for writing songs and just for playing with because they make great sounds. But the feel that you get from three pieces working together and everything is very different. Sometimes we do record a track with the drum box and I'll overdub the drums on top of them rather than the other way around. The drummer is the person in the studio who has to work the hardest at first because you have to get it right. When you're doing a track, bass, guitar, drums, you play the song, we work the song out for about half an hour, mm-hmm. and then we immediately turn the tape on and play it. None of us have heard it before half an hour ago, but we start playing it, and usually we get it within two or three takes.
Hey everybody, welcome to episode 4 of my Police album deep dive series. Today I'm going to be talking about their fourth album, Ghost in the Machine. It was released on October 2nd, 1981. The songs were recorded between January and September at AIR Studios in Montserrat and Le Studio in Quebec. Due to a fallout with manager Miles Copeland, Nigel Gray declined to produce his fourth consecutive album with the band. XTC's Andy Partridge recommended producer Hugh Pagdum, who had just worked with Phil Collins on a successful Face Value album. Whereas the band's previous album had been recorded within a tight 4-week time frame, sandwiched in between extensive tours, this time the Police booked 6 weeks of studio time at AIR Studios. Ghost in the Machine was the first Police album to prominently feature synthesizers and horns, moving the band away from their classic power trio style. Sting had recently learned to play saxophone and began incorporating the instrument with layered horn harmonies, most notably on Rehumanize Yourself and One World Not Three. All three members began using synthesizers to enhance their sound and expand their musical palette. Ghost in the Machine topped the UK album charts and peaked at number 2 on the US Billboard 200. The Police would not tour extensively in the wake of the album's release, playing only a number of small dates to promote the new record. Now, I've made no secret, Ghost in the Machine is my favorite Police album. I'm not saying it's necessarily their best album, but in terms of my own personal preference, Ghost in the Machine has always been my number one album. And it's different for a number of reasons. For starters, you got horns and synthesizers, which the Police had never used before. And it wasn't necessarily new technology, but it was new technology to the Police, and it was a technology that was rapidly progressing, and it was offering bands more option. It wasn't just strictly a keyboard instrument anymore. It could enhance guitar effects. It could enhance drum effects. But I love the fact that the Police didn't use them in a way that some other bands did, in a very cheesy kind of a way that sounds dated today. But it was territory that I think made sense for the Police to move into. They were, at the end of the day, a new wave band, and a lot of new wave bands were using synthesizers. And to their credit, Sting knew exactly how he wanted to use them without completely abandoning the classic Police sound. Now, it didn't sit very well with Andy Summers. Andy Summers kind of bemoaned the fact that they were no longer just strictly having that power trio sound, that they were starting to move away from it. And I can understand some of his misgivings about it. I mean, it had to happen. I think if the Police weren't going to stagnate, they had to start expanding their musical palette somewhat. They had to start bringing in some new textures. Sting had learned to play the saxophone. And again, I'm not a huge saxophone fan. I'm not a huge horn guy, but I do like the way that the horns are done. They're tastefully done. In some instances, there's a little bit of dissonance that the horns create, which I kind of like. I think it adds an interesting flavor to a lot of these songs. Another thing that Hugh Pagdum did which the Police had never recorded this way before. The Police had always recorded in the same room. And what Hugh did is he separated them. He had Sting in the control room with his bass plugged directly into the control board. He had Andy Summers with all of his guitars and his amplifiers in a separate room. And he had Stuart Copeland with his drums in a completely separate room. And that's the way that they recorded. So I think, you know, the style, the new sound that the Police achieved with this album wasn't just the horns and synthesizers. It was also they had a new producer and they had a new way that they were actually recording this album. And you've also got Sting writing about more global themes like One World, Not Three, Rehumanize Yourself, which was a Stuart Copeland composition. He had originally written a set of lyrics and Sting said, I'm not singing that. And Sting rewrote the lyrics. But you've got a sense, there's a sense of almost like a 1984 foreboding in some of these tracks. There's also a mindfulness of what's going on in the rest of the world. Like, started to see some of that in the songwriting on Zenyatta Mandata. But all these reasons are why this album is my favorite. I think it's so interesting. I think it's so unique compared to not only what the Police had done to that point, but to what other bands were doing at that point. So anyway, let's get into the songs on this album. So the album starts off with Spirits in the Material World, and that had to have been a real shock to the system when Police fans bought the record, put it on the turntable, and you immediately hear this synthesizer intro. And what most people don't realize is that there's synthesizers, but there's also Andy Summers' guitar lick underneath. And the synthesizers had that reggae lick like the Police used to incorporate on their early songs, where it's a choppy reggae lick. And Sting just wanted it completely synthesizer based. He didn't even want Andy Summers on the song. And Andy Summers was determined he was going to play on it. Well, his guitar playing ended up getting buried in the mix. You just hear the synthesizer. But what I love on this song is Sting's bass work is so sophisticated on here. And when you isolate the bass a little bit, or when you kind of strip away the vocals, you can hear that bass line more clearly. And you can definitely appreciate the complexity of that bass line. The lyrics are deep and mysterious. Sting had been reading a lot of philosophical books, and you can definitely tell in this songwriting and also on Synchronicity. But as a song, it hangs together so well, and it's so unique to anything that had ever been on a Police record up to that point. The second song is one of their biggest hits, Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic, and it's a magical song. This was a song that Sting had brought to the group in demo form. He'd gotten a friend of his, and I don't remember the name, to play the actual keyboard intro that you hear, the keyboard line on the synthesizer, because it was a little too complex for Sting. And he brought it to the band, and Andy and Stuart were like, how do we make this a Police song? This demo is a fully fleshed out demo. And so that was the real challenge for them, is to inject their own musical stylings into what was already a fully realized demo. But I think they did a great job with it. I love the bass on the song sounds so deep. It almost sounds like a synthesizer itself. And I love that it's just these long bass tones. And then it picks up on the chorus. But for the verses, I love how the bass sounds on the verses. And then in the chorus, you get what sounds more like the Police. But just the texture, the mood on the verses of this song, I never get tired of it. It's just a magical song. I love the coda, the EO part of the coda. The beautiful piano work on this song is just amazing. It is one of those songs that is so transcendent. Then the next track we have is Invisible Sun, a very moody, atmospheric, cinematic song. This song was about the conflicts going on in Northern Ireland. Out of any song on this album, I think it's the one that benefits the most from the use of the synthesizers. And it's just got a very foreboding kind of a mood to it. And then we've got Hungry For You, which I'm not going to try and even pronounce the French title of it. Now we're going back to where the Police are picking up a groove and they are just totally running with it. We end up down there, Saint Louis. Je veux de toi. Jusqu'à ce que je sois seul. Mais le garçon tout rouillé, complètement couvert de souhait. Nous nous noyons dans la marée, je n'ai en rond les yeux. Tu es revêche mon cœur, et moi j'ai plus qu'un seul. Mais le mouvement est chaque jour, j'aurai toujours vu le temps. You got Sting saxophone harmonies on here. That groove that they have going in this song is so amazing. I love it. Again, like those songs on Zenyatta Mandata, this groove could go on forever, and it almost does. And then Demolition Man. Now, Demolition Man was actually released back in 1981, a version of it by Grace Jones. It's time I walk in. And then that song ended up being a piece of shit. And so the Police said, well, we're going to take it back and we're going to record it the way that it was meant to be recorded. got one of those earworm bass riffs that once you heard it, it's going to be running through your head the rest of the day. It's so infectious. And you've got Andy and Stuart who are just there adding the perfect accompaniment to what is essentially, it's all about the bass. I love the horns on it. Again, Sting with the horns. But the horns aren't overpowering and they add the perfect amount of color to what essentially just could have been a bass guitar and drum workout. And then we get into the underrated side of the album. Starts off with Too Much Information. The hornlet carries a song. I love Sting harmonizing with himself. Stuart Copeland kills it on the drums. It's just a great, great song. And then we've got Rehumanize Yourself, which I've always loved the guitar playing in this song. It had just been the guitar, the bass, and the drums, it would be one thing. But now you have like these weird horn harmonies in it, some splashes of synthesizer in there as well. Just makes for such an interesting mixture of a song. Then we got a bit of world music here on One World Not Three. And I love the groove that they've got going on this song. They do a lot of interesting changes in the arrangement towards the end of this song. Sting does a great vocal on it. It's just a catchy, amazing song. You got saxophone, but not in a traditional way, not like a James Brown way, not in an R&B way. It's there to almost accentuate. I think it works brilliantly well. Then we got the Andy Summers composition, Omega Man, which, yeah, Andy Summers, one of his best compositions, one that didn't make you immediately want to pick up the needle and move it to the next song or cover your ears in horror at what you were hearing. So yeah, it's a cool little, it's a up-tempo rocker, not much in the way of synthesizers on here, no horn on here, but a blistering Andy Summers guitar solo, which is great. Stuart Copeland pounding the shit out of the drums. It's a perfect classic Police rocker. Then into Secret Journey with those moody atmospheric synthesizers, and you think it's just going to be these washes of ambient synths, and then all of a sudden the bass comes in, that bass rhythm, and then Stuart Copeland on the drums. And everything about the song works for me. I love the verses. I love the chorus itself. It really is one of those songs that's so transcendent. The synthesizers, again, they're not cheesy. They're there to provide atmosphere and mood. We'll be right back. I get put into such a headspace when I hear this song. It's a great song to drive at night too. And it's an underrated song in their catalog. I love Secret Journey. It's so perfect. And then we have the Stuart Copeland song, Darkness. Probably my favorite Stuart Copeland composition. I love the keyboard work on here. I love Sting's very low tuba sounding bass. Got some great guitar work from Andy Summers. God, I love this song. It's a great way to close out the album. That keyboard riff could just go on forever. I love the hell out of it. Every part of this album works for me. Every note of this album works for me. And I get it if you're not a Ghost in the Machine fan. I don't begrudge you that. But I am telling you, for me, Ghost in the Machine is pure Police perfection. The best thing they ever did. All right. So anyway, I'm going to come down from that and I'm going to show you the vinyl copies. This is a remastered version. This is a 180 gram press that I have. This is an early pressing of the album. And this is interesting. This is a picture disc, and it allegedly has the original running order of the album, which includes songs which had originally been B-sides, but are now here on the running order of this album. So on side one, you've got Invisible Sun, Demolition Man, Secret Journey, Darkness, Spirits of the Material World, Too Much Information, and Omega Man. And then on side two, you've got One World, Rehumanize Yourself, I Burn For You, which have been a B-side, Hungry For You, Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic, Once Upon a Daydream, which was recorded during these sessions, but ended up being the B-side. If I'm not mistaken, it was for either Synchronicity 2. I think it was the B-side of Synchronicity 2. And then we've got Shambell, which is a great instrumental. I believe it was the B-side of Every Little Thing She Does Is Magic. So interesting. I don't know if this was in fact the proposed running order or if they're just trying to sell a bunch of picture discs, but I'm a sucker for stuff like that. Cassette, I've got two cassette versions of it. The printing on one is a little, the red on the digital is a little darker, but also the cassette themselves, look a little different. And then I've got two CD copies. This was the original CD issue. And then I've got the Digipak remaster as well. So anyway, that's my Ghost in the Machine. I know this one went longer probably than most videos that I've done deep dives, but that's how much I love this album. So I will see you next time for Synchronicity.